Ken Gill had a wonderful word last night. Wasn't that just, I was up all night long. Cheryl Gill and I were talking this morning, and we're talking about, you know, releasing into different generations and seeing success in succession and all of these different things and the different perspectives of different generations. And something I told her, something that Tony Fitzgerald said to me and Bob a little while back was, he says, never look at your children and say, when I was your age. Because none of us were in their age. We were in our age. In our age, it's a whole different world. And so sometimes we try and fit our paradigm, our experience, into a world where they're trying to navigate through things. It was not even on our radar, the things that they're dealing with. And so we realize that there is a progression in the plan of God. And thank God for the roots and streams that caused us to grow, right? What we got to understand is, honorable sons and daughters in the house, we never bring indictments against the ships that brought us over, right? I mean, it's honorable what the men and women have done to get us to the place that we're at, and we got to be stewards of this holy trust. We got to defend the ancient boundary markers, the things that are non-negotiables, but we also have to be very fluid and very open to whatever the Lord is saying to us. And one of the things that Apostle Chuck would always say to us as sons is, he would always say, when you're leading, you've got to keep the end in view. You got to keep the end in view. You know, if you don't know where you're going, any road will get you there. And so many people, because I believe this, many people, because they're insecure in their identity as sons, they have to go to pastors' conferences to find who they are or what they're supposed to do and translate it. And I'm going to say this. Many times we think that the method or the means of what we do is the end, but it's only the method to the end. Sometimes we can begin to worship the wineskin like they did in the children of Israel with the serpent upon the pole. It become an idol to them. They begin to worship the methods of the old day instead of the motive. So with ARM, we're not just taking on ourselves methods, but we're taking on ourselves motives or a holy trust or a perspective that is a non-negotiable about the nature of who God is. And so that's a holy thing that we don't miscommunicate to the next generation who he is because of our methods or because of the age that we grew up in. And so in keeping the end in view, we've said for many years, and I want you to understand this, this is true. What I'm saying is true. We're in this to release the next generation. We are in this to father sons. We are in this to do a whole lot of things, right? But that is not the end. That is the means to the end. If you're going to keep the end in view, I mean, let's get real. If you're going to keep the end of view, if you release sons, then you're just sucking air and taking up space on the earth, right? And so purpose is something called original intent. What did God have in his original intent, not only for ARM, but for the whole world? And so if we can tap into that, then we can really get in the flow and really the track where God wants us to be as a people. And we can begin to see, listen, 3 and 4 generations ahead, knowing that we'll never make it there in our generation, but we can steward. Listen, we are heirs of the past, we are stewards of the present, and we are architects of the future. Right. One generation dreaming, the older generation dreaming, and another one having visions is not one's awake and one's asleep. It is one seeing something that they will never go to themselves and communicating it in a way where it becomes an active part of the life of the next generation. And so I just want to take 10 minutes here and kind of share the why we're doing what we're doing. And I want to spend the rest of the time on the blueprint of what God's given us for this age, for this season. Everything could change as far as the systems or the structures. But God inhabits systems and structures before he ever breathed the pneuma of God into Adam, the breath of God. He had to first create a body that could contain it. And so when we look at this, I just want to share a couple things that the destination, by the way, is not heaven, and the destination is not earth in where we're going. You know, many people, their goal is to make it to heaven. They believe that their reward is in heaven and that, you know, you get saved so that you can go to heaven. And that's been the doctrine of the church for years. And disclaimer, I believe you die, you will go to heaven if you believe in Jesus Christ. But I want to share something with you that can rob you of a purpose, because if our goal is to make it to heaven, just, you know, drown them in the baptismal. Just, I felt like that. I said, I'm not sure. I might mess this up in the next 5 minutes. So, you know, if my goal is heaven, let's just, and in fact, I was praying that one time, and the Lord said, I'm not looking for another dead sacrifice. That's an old covenant. I'm looking for a living sacrifice. And so we've got to walk this out. And so what was in the heart of God when he created humanity? That's something called purpose or original intent, if we can plug into that, because God has not changed his mind. And all the covenants have been to progressively bring us back to the position that Adam was in, that unique thing that he lost. And what happened was, how many know God is a builder? And we've had some great teachings. And I believe the prophetic words and the prophetic messages apostolically for the last 3 years were Tony Miller. You know, he said this, we need to move from the artistic to the architectural. John Moratori talking about generational blessing, generational vaults, and also this moving from a single cell, patriarchal, to a dual cell, which is a family carrying the nature and the culture of a people. So we see these things happening, but God is a builder. One day in heaven, you realize there was a day in which he created the heaven. Everything, the Bible says, all things were made by him and for him. And everything was in him before it ever came out, right? And so whether as angels or seraphims or cherubims or thrones or dominions or might, it was a big idea of God one day. Father, Son, Holy Ghost, communicating with each other, however that works, the mystery of the Godhead. And he decides that he is going to create a heaven. And so he creates a heaven. He creates thrones and dominions, which is in the spiritual realm. It's not in a physical realm. And what happens is one day with all of this demonstration that God did, there was a new song that was sang in the celestial bodies. And the angels begin to sing, "Holy is the Lord, for the heavens and the heavens are full of your glory." And so the stars begin to say, it says the stars, the angels sang in Noah's day. The heavens are declaring the glory of God, a dimension of God that they had never known before. But how many know God creates a sphere or a dimension, and then he matures it, develops it, and then he reveals himself in it and through it. And then all of a sudden there's no more room for any more revelation within that confines of what he created. He didn't say it's almost full. He said it's full of the glory of God. The angels is full of the glory of God, meaning we can't handle in this realm of existence anymore of who God is. And so God creates a building program to show a dimension of himself that they could never understand in the celestial bodies or in the heavenly places. And so God takes out of himself a terrestrial earth. He takes out of himself stars and dimensions and matter and seed and plants, and then he takes out of himself man, and he takes out of man, which is himself woman. And so he creates this whole new environment, listen, to demonstrate and to show a dimension of his glory that the angels had never seen yet. That's why this is a mystery to them. A dimension of his glory. But by the way, we were not created for heaven. This is where we're going. We were created for glory. Amen. We were created. What is the glory of God? It is the ability for us to carry and communicate a unique dimension of his nature that nothing has ever seen before. And we are the vice regent rulers of that revelation, because we are the masterpiece of God's creation. Blows their minds. And so Adam and the terrestrial bodies and everything, and God creates man for his glory, or to carry a dimension of himself. So the goal is not heaven. By the way, heaven, all it is a short place for us to stay for disembodied human spirits until the resurrection of the dead, and our soul and our spirit, which are already going to be glorified, meet a glorified physical body, so that we are complete in the glory of God, in the original intent in the garden. Amen. So God didn't just want us to have dominion on earth. It was a different dimension. He wanted us to have dominion on earth and in the heavenly places, dual citizenship. So I'm not saying we're not part of heaven, but what I'm saying is we're in king school while we're down here. Amen. And so God creates us to be carriers of his glory. One of the strangest things, it's so odd, in Exodus, the children of Israel have come out of Egypt, And they're going to meet God on the mountain. And we read the story where it says, you know, don't go up, don't touch it, no animals, rope off the mountain. But something happens before that. First, he talks about the angel of the Lord that's going to go before him. But something really strange is it says, and all of the elders of the 12 tribes went up with Moses and Caleb and Joshua. And it said they saw God and did not die. They saw God and did not die. And not only did they see him, they saw him on a throne seated on sapphire. And it was like God had hewed these stones to the degree that it looked like he was sitting in heaven when you're looking at him. And so they're seeing this whole sight. It's blowing their mind. God, why? Because God is showing a dimension of himself or a dimension of his glory that they are supposed to carry down that mountain to a people that have never known that before. And so God allows them not only to see that dimension of glory, but to be architects and leaders of that dimension of glory, right? Because all the covenants are to bring us from faith to faith, from glory. See, we understand thy kingdom come, thy will be done. And we understand thine is the, and the, we preach a lot on the kingdom. We preach a lot on the power. You're Pentecostals here. Every once in a while, this is just Dan, this is my little, every once in a while I wonder, whatever happened to the Pentecostal, of course, I know. But thine is the kingdom, thine is the power. But what is? Thine is the glory. That was Moses' heart. He wasn't saying, Lord, show them your heaven. He was saying, Lord, the children of Israel seen your ways in the wilderness. He said, show me your, saw your works in the wilderness. He said, teach me your ways that I might know you. He said, but show our children your glory. That's the highest, that's what we were created for. And so they saw the glory of the Lord. And it changed them. They begin to build out of that revelation. Or when they saw God in that way, they had to reorganize, become a culture, so that that which they saw on the mountain could fill that which was on the earth, where they were going, right? And there's something strange. Remember when God was about to pop a cap in the children of Israel? Because he said, in Numbers, he said, you know what, I'm done with these. I repent of ever making this group. Moses, I'll raise up another group after you. I can still preserve the seed and the promises. And Moses beseeches God on his great namesake. And the Lord says, all right, I will stay their judgment. He said, by this, he says the strangest thing. The Lord says, but I swear by myself nevertheless, the glory of the Lord will cover the face of the earth. That was it. Why are we still here? Because the glory of the Lord. It wasn't just about filling the earth with a family. It was about filling the earth with a family who carries the nature of God, his government, his ways and his means. And so one of these days the Bible says that the glory of the Lord is going to cover the face of the earth as the water covers the sea. And one of these days there's going to be a new song that's going to be sang. And it's going to be about that glory. But until then, that's where we're at right now. The mystery of the ages is not Christ in you, the hope you make it to heaven. The exceeding greatness and the riches of God is locked up in his glory, it says. And so we are each created to glorify God in a unique facet, in a unique way that nobody else can. Jesus, when he's about to die, he says, remember, he says, I fulfilled the work that you've called me to do, in that I haven't lost one that you've given me, save the son of perdition. I have released the next generation. But he said this, he said, now, Father. He didn't say, now, Father, take me to heaven. Heaven with him was not a place, it was a state of being, a relationship. He was going to break off the limitations of this wet pair of overalls called humanity. And he was going to take upon that glorified body in that place that he was with the Father. He said, it's finished. I've done the work you've called me to do. He says, now glorify me with the glory that you had before the world was. It says, and we beheld his glory, even the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. And so what are you saying? What I'm saying is our motivation is our destination. And if our motivation is to have more people, raise kids, and have bigger churches. Even though we do it in Christ's name, it's humanistic. It's all centered around us. God is not an end, but God is a means to an end. He's created we're created for him, but he, in our mind, he was created by us and for us for our purposes and for our needs. But it's not that way. We were created for something unique in his glory. I want to read two scriptures, and then I want to begin to get about the blueprint of what we're trying to do. If you've got your Bibles, Colossians 1 and 24, just to kind of seal this in you. This is about now our teaching where just this teaching, which I'm not going to get into today, where it tells of all of the things that humanity is to train and teach angels. Hebrews 1 says that humanity is designed to teach angels sonship. Because to what angel has he called my son? Colossians 1, 24, it says, I now rejoice in my sufferings for you and fill up in my flesh what is lacking in the afflictions of Christ for the sake of his body, which is the church, of which I became a minister according to the stewardship God which has given me to me for you to fulfill the word of God, the mystery which has been hidden from ages and from generations, but now is being revealed to the saints. This was hidden. You do understand that the Old Testament or the Old Covenant was a glorious covenant, but it has an inferior glory to the one that we have. It's an inferior revelation. It says, to them, God willed to make known what are the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. This is what arms carrying. This is the mystery that we're carrying. This is the thing the world doesn't get. Him we preach, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom that we may present every man perfect in Christ. To this end, I also labor, striving according to his working, which works in me mightily. What is he striving? To what end is he striving? So that we would understand the glory that is to be revealed in us. Christ in us, the hope of glory. Hebrews 2 and 5, I want to read that really quick as well. But he has not put the world to come, of which we speak, in subjection to angels, but one testified in a certain place. What is man that thou art mindful of him, or the son of man that you take care of him? You made him a little lower than the angels, and you've crowned him with glory and honor, and set him over all the works of your hand. Remember, he crowned us with glory and honor. Apostle Ken speaking about honor last night. To put all things in subjection under his feet. For in that he put all things in subjection under him, he left nothing that is not under him. But now we have not yet seen the all things that are put under him. But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels, for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he may by the grace of God might taste of death for everyone. For it was fitting that in him, for whom all things and by all things are, bringing many sons into glory and to make the captain of their salvation, perfect through sufferings. And we could just continue to go on that. I believe that every generation carries a dimension of God's glory. And I just believe this. With the passing of Apostle Chuck, his generation faithfully stewarded the revelation of the glory of God. And we saw and still do see things in them that have given us vision and motivation to do what God's called us to do. But I believe, as far as the arm network, that our wineskin has outgrown, our structure is limiting the wine that God wants to pour in through the glory of God. In the same way as one covenant limits, I believe that what God wants to do, every generation starts out as a patriarchal generation. And you look at Moses. Moses spent most of his time moving out of something instead of moving into something. And Ken said it last night, you know what? One of the greatest things about moving into what God has for you is unlearning things, not what you're learning. And so we see with Apostles' generation that many times it was about getting things out of our system that God never wanted. And we built tabernacles where God didn't even want tents in some places, so that another generation could then begin to move into a new level of grace. And so when we look at this right now, with the passing of Chuck, there was this great wrestling and this war inside of us of succession, because we preach father, son, relational blessing, generational blessing, but we had never seen an organization translate very good. Now you can translate really good if you have a real spiritual son or you have a natural son that's a spiritual son, take the church, like Daryl Bennett did. But organizationally, I want to say something, that this is a different dimension with ARM, because we're not a single church. We are a network of networks. And when somebody like Apostle Chuck passes on, you don't, by virtue of his death, become the spiritual son of Bob Houselman. Because these are boundary lines of affection and adoration. It's a loving allegiance. It's a loving honor. It's not something that you just give yourself to. And so when the shepherd is smote, it's like the sheep scatter. We kind of lose our identity, because first generation, it is built most of the time around a personality, and God mightily uses these couples to do that. But when they pass on, what happens is you've got to move from the single person anointing, which we all, the plant churches do that. You've got to shift into a plurality. It's got to be a family structure. It's got to be a different type of rhythm. Now we're not just reflecting the giftings and the personality of a person, but we're reflecting the nature and value system of a corporate group of people. It's not just reflecting the needs of a person who carried a great dimension of it, but now, unless the seed die, it remains alone. Now through what Chuck had placed inside of us and many others, now it is passing. It is calling us up, not just to a new place of responsibility, but a new wineskin to release in the next generation. I want to share something with you. This rough road that we're going through and have gone through in this transition thing, we are going to be the first fruits of many organizations that will atrophy and die if they don't find the way. And so it's worth it to hit some chuck holes, and it's worth it to cut some paths, and it's worth it to lay some big number five gravel so that the next generation has a nice, clean, paved way so they don't have to worry about the things we do. And so it's changed. Because Chuck could not look at any one of us and say, you're supposed to take it. Because in the same way with Jesus, he didn't appoint one. He released 12 to rock the world. And so in the plurality of leaderships, it's not an elder-run scenario, though. I mean, a lot of times we say we do that, and then we slide into denominationalism again. And that's not the heart of this organization or of this network. But when we look, as we move, we're not taking away the old. Everybody's got to start with what we would call a patriarchal pastoral. But now we're going to go and be a family led by fathers. One brother said, who was passing on his church, he said, you don't have to choose between me and brother such and such, because you get us all. In the old paradigm, if you were going to pass or release something, you had to leave or you had to die. And for the last 3 years of Apostle Chuck's life, I had taken on myself the task as vice president. He had a great need and a great burden for succession. And everywhere we looked, we could not find anybody that had done it successfully. And everybody that had done it, that given to their spiritual sons, within 6 months to 2 years, they had taken it back. And a major decline on people that carried the glory of God and the move of God happened. And we just said, we don't want to do that. I mean, if we need to lay hands on everybody and we just separate and go build our own thing. But listen, I don't care if you're Jesse Duplantis or Benny Hinn. If you build on your own personality, on your own gift, you are still only one generation. We have an opportunity to do an arm. It's not about how many is a part of your network, because the day that person passes, if you don't see things through this lens, what happens is the organization is destroyed. It becomes a one generational wonder. I do want to say that it does not mean that the essence or the values or things are not continuing to go to the earth and stewarded in other places, but I think that there's something different with us, because we fell in love with each other through our relationship with Karen Clayton and Chuck Clayton. We fell in love with them, and then we fell in love with each other. And when Papa Chuck had passed on, we were like, you know, some people are going to go find other fathers, other networks and stuff. But we became a community. We went from being like in Israel, coming out of Egypt, we went from being a mixed group of people to becoming a culture. And our culture is not something that we nail up 10 tenets of faith. It is a value system that always exalts relationship above methods. And so with this, I believe that we've come up with kind of a blueprint or maybe a prototype of moving into this. And what Apostle Ken had said, how many of you know we're going to make a lot of mistakes along the way? There's certain things that we're actually pioneering in this, because I can honestly say we've looked everywhere. I have looked, spent tens of thousands of dollars and hundreds of hours looking for a prototype, and I have not found one. But one thing about this organization is they've always been, this family, we've always been in the middle, it seems like, for the 15, 16 years, in the middle of whatever God was doing. And I look at the history of this organization and what God has done also. But we also got to understand in 1 Corinthians, it says, if you're going to build on another man's foundation, you got to build wisely. He's speaking to the Corinthians, and he says something really profound. First off, he says, y'all are immature. Now realize they're going through a leadership transition scenario. And some have Paul, some have Apollos, and some have Cephas. And so the very thing that was designed to strengthen the organization now becomes a group of comparisons. And Paul says, it's not good that I come to you speaking like this, because some of you are saying, I'm from Cephas, I'm from Apollos, and I'm from Paul. And we were never designed, these giftings were never designed, the plurality, to divide you, but to establish you. God didn't give you twos and threes so that you can pick your favorite speaker and not show up when the other ones are preaching. Listen, he chose the two and threes because you need it.
That's right. Yeah.
Because God is always Father, and God is always Son, and God is always Holy Ghost. So the Lord is desperately wanting in this organization and in this family to establish in a threefold cord that won't easily be broken. We also want to steward this so that it is never a question. We want to answer the question in anyone's mind. If God gives us another 1,000 years on this earth, how can we continue to preserve the relational integrity of this organization and at the same time pass it on to the next generation of sons, not managers? That's a tall statement. And so what we've decided in moving forward with this, that we would go from a leader with a team in arm to a team with a leader, or a team with leaders. A patriarchal model to a sonship family structure, not only connecting with a personality, but connecting with a people that have vision, mission, and purpose according to what the Founding Father has laid for us out of his revelation. The new leadership style will move from a single cell leader to a multi-cell or dual cell leader. We have chosen the method of three leaders, because God establishes in twos and threes, but Jesus sent them out in threes, okay? And I think it's very important, especially for the culture. How many of you know it's really important that we don't just change the terminology to do what everybody else is doing?
Right.
Now that we've got a revelation of apostles, we do the same thing we always did. We just call them apostles. So we're not, we are not just changing the terminology. We are changing the nature of the thing as far as the structure. Why are we changing the structure? Because if we don't, we are going to limit the glory of God that's going to be revealed in this next generation. I'm going to say that again. If we do not move into this, we will eat the seed of our inheritance, and we will limit the glory of God that is wanting to move in this greater capacity within us. And so the reason why we don't have two is because if we just had, say, a Bob and a Jamie, it would smell too much like associate pastor. Does that make sense? I mean, people would walk in, and before they even knew what we were, they would know what we were. The reason why we don't have four is so that we don't end up with a democracy of dictators. We don't have a democracy where everybody, I'm going to have to figure this out. So I believe that three is a good number when we begin to establish it, because God wants to establish something generationally. So with the three, Bob Houselman, Jamie Englehart, and I are looking, if you receive us or so, as moving into this next dimension in this new wineskin. We're establishing an apostolic accountability as well. So we have an apostolic team, which you don't have to choose between Bob, Jamie, or I. You get all of us, whether you like it or not. but we also saw, how many of you know, the Bible says wisdom is known of her children. And so sons can easily look back and see the mistakes that the last generation made because they didn't live it. They weren't coming out of what they were coming out of. But we don't criticize it, but we are supposed to take heed of it and learn. And so one of the things that we saw that limited the glory of God and the grace of God in organizations where spiritual fathers would grow up and they would really have no accountability within their networks. And networks would grow. We expect church members to tithe because that's a healthy thing for them and a healthy thing for glorifying God. We also expect churches to tithe, and because in what we would call the Feast of Tabernacles, if you believe it, is a future event or a present event. The reality is we see collective souls and nations tithing to a nation, Israel. So a person tithing to a person, an Abraham and a Melchizedek, a collective soul or a nation tithing and giving offerings to nations. And so us being a nation, a community, and a family, we believe that we needed the same accountability that we expect people to have with us. And so we have a board of advisors, apostolic fathers, that are not in arm, and they serve as a tenure. They commit themselves at least for 1 year at a time, and it is Tony Fitzgerald, right? A man by the name of David Briggs as well. And these guys, I'll tell you what, they are completely off the charts as far as their integrity, as far as their love for us, and Billy Epperhart as well. So we've got these three. And I want you to know, these are all three different streams. They are completely different, but one thing they do, they all know us. They all love us, and we spend real quality time. So what we do as an organization, we believe that we need to open ourselves up to accountability and correction as well. So if there's ever a problem, we have a team of apostolic fathers outside the organization that will hold us accountable, but also give us wisdom and knowledge and understanding on where we're moving to. Out of that, we believe that there's an honor system that has got to take place, and that is that we would split a tithe between these three men. Also, putting the first among equals with these, as well, Karen Clayton, which is the mother of this organization and is worth double honor. And we are committed in our hearts and in our desire to continue to not only grow in numbers, to influence and affect people, but also to help her and to grow her in her capacity and her security, and to consistently and continue to honor Mama Karen all the days that we possibly can that God gives us on the earth. And so we are so thankful that she's not a part of our past, but she is a part of our future as well. And we believe that God, as we honor and love and seek her advice on things, that in the future as well, she will be a voice into our destiny. Because there's a reason why the Lord allowed Chuck to come at this time, but there is also a reason why she is still here and still in our lives. And so we honor you, Mom, and we thank you so much. And so where we're going in our future, we want to continue to support her financially to the best degree that we can. And so does everybody have an amen with that? Is that okay? And so we will establish an apostolic oversight team and have. We will also keep the honorary system as a culture of honor and spiritual sons and daughters. Now's when we get into the qualifications. What qualifies? Now, this is for the future. What qualifies us to stand in the place of a Chuck Clayton? That's a huge gap, because all of us have had our own experiences and our own things, but what qualifies us to be apostolic leaders of this organization? We begin to go through a list of things that we believe is not only healthy for this transition, but it is healthy for every transition after this. Remember this, we're not responding to need right now. We are architecturally building for the future, right? Because when you're responding to need, sometimes that's a 10-minute, 10-year solution. But what we're looking at is 3 and 4 generations, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And so when we look at the qualifications of the apostles to lead the armed family, first and foremost, one of which, of course, other than saved, filled with the Holy Ghost, and believe in the fivefold, they must have served Chuck Clayton and Karen Clayton as first-generation sons and actually been entertained as successors. And so first generation, the apostles of Jesus Christ, they were the ones that walked with him. Remember, the apostle Paul was born out of due season because he never actually lived with him. He was like a prototype of the next generation that was going to carry on. But with us, to keep the essence and the integrity and the vision, because each one of us carry a different perspective, but we all carry the same heart that Chuck Clayton had for the people and for God making it to where it's supposed to be. So I think it is important that only sons can inherit such a family. And with that, it is very important that each and every one of us that step into this position were spiritual sons, tithing spiritual sons that served the network and served the family. And I think we've all done that for over a decade. Another thing with the apostolic is that we have got to be apostles that are not only recognized by arm, but we are recognized, commissioned, and released as an apostolic blessing from many other streams and many other people. At every one of our apostolic ordinations, we had more apostles from outside of our network than apostles from inside of our network, because there was a consensus. Our metron, or our measure, was beyond the sphere of apostolic resource ministries, in the same way that Chuck's sphere was beyond apostolic resource ministries as well. And so we're not apostles because we took a vote and we decided that most of ARM likes us. Because if only your family thinks you're a pastor, you're probably not one, right? If it's your mom and your three cousins, you can get away with certain stuff. But when you get out in the real world, right, and you're ministering, whether they recognize that apostolic grace on your life or not, is very important. So we see that the validation of the apostolic ministry, that you are a real bona fide apostle. Why am I going to seat on this? I'm doing this because I've seen many people that weren't apostles step into places and destroy their lives and destroy networks. What's Bob said before, if anybody wants this, read the qualifications. Scourged and rejected and misunderstood and all that other stuff. So the reality is serving Apostle Chuck, being recognized by senior apostolic leaders, commissioned from them and by them into the grace that God's given us. So that, listen, it's important that that outside force of favor is connected, because we will become a cult if we don't. We will atrophy. Now, it doesn't mean you're apostle to everybody. Governmentally, we're apostles here, but as far as blessing, we should be to the whole earth, or to those that God's given us as far as relationships. How many know at the end of the day, a lot of times, it comes down, what was the number one thing why people were not able to do this? The number one reason that kills a patriarchal organization from moving into a family team fathering organization is this: the money. We saw many, many good leaders who could not make the transition because the thought of the lack of funds and the shifting. We just decided, listen, they were first generation fathers that had never been fathered. Does that make sense? Listen, our spiritual fathers, they didn't have an inheritance. They were a bunch of orphans in the spirit, or as far as within the system, and they pulled themselves up by their bootstraps. They heard the heart of Father God crying out to them. And so, no, they did not build as far as legacy because they didn't have an inheritance to build on. Yes. But we do. We have a legacy. We have an inheritance. And so with that, the money is an important thing. If you can solve the money issue with this, listen, that's a huge key. So we decided if you were going to be an apostolic leader of this organization, you cannot need the money. Because, I mean, money jacks people up. I've seen good elders until you give them a salary. And then they sit down and become like a 10-year Supreme Court justice for the rest of their life, you know. And they made it into that position because it wasn't about the money. But as soon as they got the money, it contaminated or something, or brought something to the surface. And it went from being a labor of love to receiving a wage. They went from being a son to being a hireling. And so we said, we don't ever want this generation to have to deal with that. And so if your apostolic sphere and influence is not big enough to take care of you, you do not need to lead a network of networks, a network of ministers, and a network of ministries. Because then I'm free not to, therefore I am free to.
That's right?
Because then when we stand up as apostolic leaders and we're not worried about the money to the degree that, oh my gosh, I'm about to lose my income. It is not a retirement program for Bob, nor a living wage for Dan Dyer. We are taken care of. as far as what we built business. The Bible says that we can't divorce ourselves from Luke 16. Faithful with little, faithful with that which is another man, and faithful with money. You do not want somebody that has not been a good steward of their own money and their own ministry's money leading this organization. I promise you that.
That's right. That's right.
And so with this prototype, therefore, Bob and Jamie and because we have our own spheres with him, and Bob is a unique, he is an Isaac between two generations. Because he was raised up in the culture of Arn, but through the grace of God in him and Sarah's life, they built something significant. So with them, of course, as he moves, which we all move out of our organizations and our leadership roles in it, we've said, you know, we want to supplement Bob's salary to a great degree. But we also don't want to set up a wineskin that will be destroyed because of the money problem. And so we saw a clear biblical example of how to handle finances in the future when you move from the patriarchal model, which in the patriarchal model, they're pioneers. They go years without nothing, and usually by about time they're able to get the fruit of their labor, God takes them home. That's why we always got to make sure we honor our past, right? Because they are still part of our future. But with this, there's something when you move from the inheritance into the inheritance, from a father to the inheritance of a collective soul of a group of people, there's something called the double portion. And the double portion is a method or a way in which we communicate the heart, the honor system, the value system of sonship. But we're not putting somebody on the throne becoming the Pope again. And so with that, what happens? If I had a chart, everybody understand what the double portion is? The first son, which, by the way, we believe that as an apostolic team, we are not all equals in position, though we are equals in value.
Right. Right.
We're not equals in position, but we are equal in value. So Bob Houselman, we realize this, you cannot become a board-run organization. Every organization needs a leader. But he is, and we are a family or a team with a leader, not a leader with a team. So what happens is with Apostle Bob, he is the first among equals. And so he is the leader of organization. We come alongside him and we serve him and serve you alongside of him. But at the end of the day, he becomes the fathering spirit of the organization with the plurality of the giftings. Not only with Jamie and I, but this whole group. We're all gifts to one another. It's not... We're just facilitating the gifts in people. We're not the gift. We're hopefully releasing the gifts and the grace. And so with this, let's say if we have a $40,000 a year budget for salaries for apostolic honorarium, what we would do would Bob would get $20,000, Jamie and I would get $10,000. We can just talk this way because this is you've got to know this. Because then what it does, he gets double honor, right? And we also end up getting enough to where we can travel and meet the needs and hopefully be an apostolic blessing to the family. But it's not built upon one man in the next generation since. And so then if the Lord takes Bob home and this thing goes on, what happens is out of the collective soul of this organization, listen, we don't have to find another Bob Houselman or another Chuck Clayton. All we got to do is raise up another spiritual apostolic son that is a leader whose sphere's grown, and then all of a sudden, me or Jamie, we just move aside and we just say, just get on up here with me. We just say, get on in here, Reggie. Get on out of here. And there's a mentoring, there's a training, there's an opportunity. And so we never have to feel like orphans in a fathering movement ever again.
Amen.
And there's no jealousy and there's no jockeying for positions. And so I believe with this answers the major conflicts that keep people from moving into a generational model. And our responsibilities, by the way, I will say this, along with that, how many know we want to give large margin of error? We're going to do this for 4 years. And if we get a revelation that's greater than this, why 4 years? Because Jesus gave the thing 3 years to produce fruit. And then out of his mercy, he dug it and dunged it and gave it another year. So we're not like setting precedent and making policy to the degree where if God shows us something as we begin to take off on the runway, we can't pull back in the garage and fix a few things, right? And so 4 years, I would ask you to commit to this unless you have a better idea. Right? Our responsibilities are simple. To serve out of affectionate allegiance for God and for what our founding fathers have laid. To preach the gospel of the kingdom of Jesus Christ. To prayer and fast for our armed family. To develop leaders and teams of leaders. To carry the nature of what has been laid for us and taught to us for generations. To provide resources to establish and plan armed family events. To help ordain, commission, bless, and strengthen armed churches, armed ministers, and armed leaders. And future armed apostles will be raised up from among us. Because you got to know those that labor among you. But with a plurality of apostolic leaders, I believe it is a healthy wineskin for our churches to become all that God has called them to be in this unique age that we find ourselves in. I'm done at this time, but I could take 5 seconds. Does anybody have any questions about anything else? Anything just Reggie likes it. That's why I brought him up as possibly the next apostle, because we had agreement. Anybody have? Yes, brother. Yeah, are you a member of ARM? You're a member of ARM? Well, kind of our philosophy of this organization, if you've been with us for a while, it is all family. It is all interdependence. I mean, in our sphere, kind of what you said is kind of a different language, because we've always cross-pollinated, cross-related, and promoted each other. We believe that the apostolic and the prophetic are not on the steeple, but they are on the foundations, lifting up the other ministry gifts of Christ. And so, yeah, we embrace the giftings of others, and we'll continue to network within and without of the organization. Does anybody else have any other questions? Brother Rob? The question is this: where do we see ARM at in the future? Because when we started out, listen, how many of you know this is the part of the progressive plan of God, and that is a good question. You know, we can say 40,000 foot, the glory of God emanating and blasting through every nostril and every pore, you know, I mean, of each and every one of us. But the reality is when we started out as a bunch of fathers that weren't fathered. And Chuck's mantra was this: I looked to my right and I looked to my left, the Psalm of David, and nobody stood with me, nobody cared for my soul. So in Apostle Chuck's generation, the apostolic was born, the fathering movement was born out of no man should ever have to stand by themselves and go through the things that we went through. So they become first generation fathers because of that. But through the process of adopting that philosophy, we realized that we were not just coming out of something that was limiting the family expression, but we're moving into something. So as the future, as we grow in the future, it's not just only about helping struggling pastors, but actually beginning to build a culture that has the nature of Christ as family. And also, one of the things we've seen through the years is most apostolic organizations, you go to their conferences and they're all apostles, or they think they are. You go to a pastor's conference and they're all licking their wounds and you know, talking. You go to prophetic conferences, everybody's prophesying over each other. You go to worship conferences, everybody worshiping with each other, you know. But what I see that's different in ARM is that there is a true fivefold expression in us to equip the saints for the work of ministry. And I do want to say this as well. We really believe that within the context of ARM, it is not apostles' resource ministries, it is apostolic resource ministries. We believe in all of the gifts and all the administrations and facilitating that, and as well as with teams and going out and launching. One of the things I want to say about, along with apostles, is we desperately need prophets like Meinrad and others to come up alongside of us in this. One brother looked at me and said for the next season, he believed that the apostles would have to be pastored by prophets. Do you understand what I'm saying? that apostles are trying to build something, but sometimes we don't see as clear as we need to. And so what happens, the interpretation of what we're feeling, God brings prophets alongside and helps us to clarify the vision so that we continue to build something on earth that reflects. Because God's not looking for a bigger building. He's looking for a bigger people. And so we believe that we are the building of God, and that in the future that we are going to have multiple streams. We are a network. Chuck's desire in his last days that we would be a network of networks. There are networks that are as alone as pastors right now. And so that we could be a resource and a blessing to them governmentally, and also the force of favor, a blessing upon them as well. And so. Okay. If there's nothing else, I'm going to close. Anybody else just got 5-minute break, and then we'll come back in here, and Apostle Jamie's going to share with us. Thank you.